Hello dear students, welcome to the lecture on measurements and instrumentation. Today we will be discussing the topic ballistic galvanometer. So as the name indicates, this is a galvanometer. So galvanometer can be thought of something like a moving coil instrument. So here also the working principle is very similar to a moving coil instrument. But there are slight variations. So in this ballistic galvanometer, this particular meter is used to assess the amount of charge flow that is developed in a magnetic circuit due to the flux linking with the surge coil connected to its terminals. Now what do you mean by a surge coil? Here we can take an example. So here this is an iron core, and this iron core is being wound with a magnetizing winding or the primary winding. So this can be termed as a magnetizing winding, and this particular magnetic circuit is being energized from this magnetizing winding. Now what happens is that you have this secondary winding which is connected, and this secondary winding is connected to the galvanometer, and this secondary winding can be termed as the surge coil. Some flux will be developed in the surge coil when the flux links with the this particular primary winding. Flux in the iron core that will be linking with the surge coil, and that flux will be in turn producing some current in this secondary circuit. And you have a galvanometer connected in the secondary circuit, so that galvanometer produces some variation or some deflection due to this current that is due to this particular change in flux. Now this particular ballistic galvanometer, the deflection is proportional to the quantity of charge that is passing through it. Now this is the one important aspect of ballistic galvanometer is that this is used to identify impulsive nature of current or charge that is flowing through it. That is, you have some charge flow for a small duration, okay, from T1 to T2. Okay, so because of this charge flow for very small duration, once you integrate this, so this is your charge Q. Once you integrate this, you will get the current that is flowing from T1 to T2. So that will be a finite value of current or finite value of charge that is flowing between or through the galvanometer for a very small duration of time. So such a small duration charge or current can be identified with the galvanometer, and a deflection will be occurring. And normally a moving coil galvanometer is also provided with a mirror in case of ballistic galvanometer in order to identify the deflection. Okay, here instead of pointers we are using mirrors to identify the angle by which here this particular moving system is being deflecting. Also this moving system is provided with zero damping or minimum damping, so that your vibration of the moving system or the mirror arrangement is you will get the maximum vibrations or oscillations. So oscillations is not dampened out, so you need to get oscillation so that at the first oscillation, whenever you have impulse produced, so you'll have a number of oscillations. So during the first oscillation it will be maximum, so you'll have maximum deflection in the first oscillation. So you are providing with a minimum damping and also a large moment of inertia. So providing with the large moment of inertia, in the sense you'll have larger weight of the moving system, so that produces sustained oscillation and produces a long period of vibration. And oscillations are also damping out slowly because your damping is very minimum, or you can almost consider it to be zero. Now the ballistic galvanometer consists of copper wire, very similar to a normal galvanometer, which is wound over this aluminium frame. Now instead of a phosphor bronze spring, here we are using phosphor bronze ribbon. So this particular moving system is suspended from a using a phosphor bronze ribbon, and you are also provided with a mirror arrangement and a light. So once a deflection occurs, this light source will be directed towards the scale. So depending on the position of the light, you can get the reading. So phosphor bronze springs acts as a path for conduction of the current into the system, and you are also provided with a spring at the bottom, and this ribbon allows a coil to twist. So you'll have a twist corresponding to the deflection torque that is produced. So instead of the spring acting, here we have the ribbon. So ribbon will be twisting, and that twist will be recorded on the or will be shown on the scale using a light mirror arrangement. So the iron core or the moving coil is placed within the poles of the magnet that we already know, and a spring is also provided, which provides the restoring torque. Okay, so that is also being provided. So damping is minimum, it provides the restoring torque, so that will be coming back to its normal position once your deflecting torque ceases, or the energy is being completely removed. Now, the working principle is very simple. Now, this is the image for a practical ballistic galvanometer. Here you can see it is enclosed in a case, and an opening is provided here. So from here we have the mirror provided, and light source can be directed from the outside, and the light will be falling on this mirror, and it will be reflected back towards a scale which is also kept outside. Now a short burst of current or an impulsive current passing through the galvanometer, and once the current is passing through it, there will be a minimum rotation, and once entire energy is passed through the galvanometer, you will have maximum deflection of the or rotation of this particular moving system. Once the energy is completely delivered to the coil, that will be proportional to the charge that is flowing in that particular coil. So the charge associated or the energy associated with the charge will be completely delivered to the coil, and once that happens, your deflection will be occurring. Now you will have an angular impulse produced on this particular moving system. It is very similar to a bullet striking a pendulum. So once the bullet is striking the pendulum, at that moment you will not have any oscillation. So once the entire energy is being passed on to the pendulum, you will have deflections. Similarly, the impulse will be depending on the torque that is produced, which is proportional to the current that is flowing for a short duration. Also, it depends on the time interval during which the torque is applied. So if you are applying the energy taking longer time, the impulse will be minimum. The impulse has to be, the angular impulse has to be maximum once there will be a torque, as well as the time duration will be minimum, so that your impulsive value will be high. So this peak will be high. So this angular impulse will be delivered to the coil, and it produces an angular momentum. So this impulse will be producing a momentum which causes the coil or the moving system to deflect, and this deflection is in terms of swing. And this swing the swing will be continuing until the kinetic energy that is gained during this process, that is due to the impulse, you will have some kinetic energy produced in the moving system that has been completely converted to potential energy of the ribbon suspension. So once it is converted to potential energy, you will have a swing. So swing will be stopping once the entire kinetic energy is being converted to potential energy, or you have a restoring torque from the this ribbon mechanism. So once you have a restoring torque from the ribbon mechanism, the entire energy is being converted, and you will have the maximum swing in that at that till that point. Now coming on to the theory of operation, so you have a you can consider a rectangular coil having n number of turns placed in a uniform magnetic field, and let L be the length and B be the breadth of the coil. The area of the coil is given by length into breadth, and when the impulsive current I passes through the coil, the torque, deflecting torque produced will be produced, and this torque is can be termed in terms of number of turns current, the flux density, the area, as well as the flux density B. Okay, so this equation we have already derived in case of your normal galvanometer. Now assume that the current is flowing through the coil for a very short duration dt. Now if that is the case, the impulse produced, the angular impulse produced by the coil is tau into dt. So the whatever the torque that is produced or the force that is produced, you multiply with the time, you will have some impulse produced. So that is ni ba into dt. So the total angular impulse produced that for t seconds, from 0 to t seconds, is obtained by integrating this. So you will be getting the charge q, nba into q. Okay, so that is the total amount of charge that is flowing in this coil, or charge that is passing through the coil. Now the moment of inertia is defined as J, and the angular velocity which causes this moment of inertia, or which changes, is given by omega. Now the angular momentum is given by J into omega. Now this angular momentum is due to the force acting on the coil, or due to the angular impulse. So this both terms can be equated. So you'll have angular momentum equal to the impulsive torque that is produced, or angular impulse that is produced. So that will be J omega will be equal to NBA into Q, or you can NBA by J into Q. So this is considered as equation number 1. Now the kinetic energy of the system, so you already told, is completely used to push the suspension wire through an angle theta. So whatever the kinetic energy that is gained during the process, during this impulsive current, some torque will be produced. Then due to that, some kinetic energy will be produced. That kinetic energy will be entirely converted to the restoring force, or will be converted to potential energy of the ribbon suspension. Now it will be deflected through an angle theta, and let K be the constant of restoring couple per unit twist of suspension wire, or it is very similar to the spring constant. If you have a spring, it is very similar to spring constant. So the restoring torque is given by half K theta square. So this is the work done in twisting the wire through an angle theta, and the kinetic energy is given by half J omega square, where J is your moment of inertia and omega is the angular velocity. Now you can equate the two energies, the kinetic energy as well as the restoring force or the potential energy. So from that you will get K theta square is equal to J omega squared, which can be considered as equation number 2. Now we will be substituting the value of equation 1 in equation 2. So equation 1 was this omega is equal to NBA by J into Q. So when you substitute that in omega, so instead of omega you are substituting that term, and you can simplify it, take a square root, and then you can express it in terms of Q and theta. So where Q can be termed as some constant into theta, and this particular constant is known as ballistic reduction factor. So from this relationship you can say that your Q will be proportional to theta, or whatever the deflection that is occurring, that can be in terms of Q. So once you get the deflection, you can express this deflection in terms of the charge that is flowing through that particular coil. Now remember, this charge is not flowing for a long duration, so it is flowing, we are considering the case where your charge is flowing for only a short duration. Just like in the case we have taken the first example where you are having a magnetizing coil and the magnetizing coil is being magnetized using a DC source. So once you switch on the supply, you'll have some change in the magnetism. So that change is being identified using this ballistic galvanometer as a change in charge flow through this galvanometer. So in such cases, in case of discharge of the capacitor, so that is also can be considered as an impulsive value where the current is changing from high value to low value in very short duration. So in such cases, you can use this ballistic galvanometer to identify the charge that is flowing through the meter for a very short duration of time. And further, this can be further extended to find out the flux that is produced. Okay. From the charge, you can also identify the flux that is produced, and you will be making some modifications and you will be getting a meter which is known as flux meter, which will be discussed in the next lecture. So this ballistic galvanometer is primarily used to identify the charge that is flowing, and with some modifications it can also be used to identify the flux that is in this, or that is being produced in this particular system, in this particular circuit.